A PDF of additional material accompanies this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents Our Hidden Conversations: What Americans Really Think About Race and Identity by Michele Norris. Read by the author with a full cast.
For Betty and Belvin Norris, they gave me the gift of curiosity, forever grateful. For Broderick and our kids, who cheered me up and cheered me on during this journey, love you all so very much. I'm blessed to have a partner who understands that love is the best part of any story. For Carter and the world I hope you will inherit.
They ask me to remember, but they want me to remember their memories. And I keep on remembering mine. Lucille Clifton.
Prologue, A Magnificent Detour. This book is the result of a magnificent detour. More than a decade ago, I set out to write a book about how Americans talk and think about race. The rise of Barack Obama's political fortunes at that time was beginning to shift how the nation saw itself. The changes were both intense and highly nuanced. Tea Party followers in Uncle Sam costumes began taking to the streets and screaming, "I want my country back." Latino voters met anger with anticipation, marching for immigration reform with signs in the air and hope in their hearts. Black voters quite literally wore pride on their shoulders. Barack to the Future t-shirts were on back order. People long consigned to America's margins were holding themselves taller, feeling a swell of pride stoked by a political victory that many had once considered unimaginable. Even some of the political operatives who fought the Obama campaign with every fiber of their beings conceded that the occasion of the first black family moving into the White House was an undeniable milestone. And to many, that mark felt like a thunderclap, signaling upending change. America's demographics were shifting. A nation built on a foundation of white supremacy was heading toward majority-minority status. In popular media, this was heralded as progress, but in private spaces and quiet conversations, this shift was also met with dread and anxiety. After all, if you've paid any attention to how minorities have been treated in this country over centuries, you might reasonably be concerned about becoming one. And demographic change was just one jolt amid a ripple of seismic shocks, because it was happening alongside so many other cultural shifts: economic tumult, technological upheaval, global conflict, the normalization of gay marriage, and the widening embrace and celebration of LGBTQ+ life, the centering of Latino language and culture, a warming climate, unapologetic white nationalism, growing diversity in advertising and entertainment, and of course, that constant stream of videos capturing the killings of black Americans by police or would-be vigilantes. All of it was amplified, exaggerated, or ingested through social media platforms that seemed to fertilize the most fetid of human emotions: anger, umbrage, envy, shame, or fear. All of it added up to vertigo. I wanted to chronicle the visible changes in the United States, but more than that, I wanted to somehow capture the subtler subterranean shifts. I grew up with old folks who used to say that if you listen to the little noises an old house made, the hiss of the boiler, the strain of pipes snaking through the walls, the crackle and pop of wood adjusting to weather or weathering from too many people occupying too small a space, it would reveal a narrative emerging on the horizon. I wanted to hear the crackle and pop coming from society's structural alterations. I wanted to put my ear to the private conversations, spurred on by new realities and changing demographics. I had a plan, I landed a book contract, and then I took a left turn. After listening to the changing conversation among the elder African Americans in my family, I wound up writing a completely different book, a family memoir called The Grace of Silence. The election of Barack Obama ushered in a whoosh of candor from the older folks who'd raised me. Proud as they were of a moment that felt like touching America's summit, they couldn't help but think about their own long climbs up the rough side of the mountain. The elders began unburdening themselves by shedding stories they had long kept to themselves. I learned that my father had been shot in the leg by a police officer in Birmingham, Alabama in 1946, while entering a building to join fellow Black World War II veterans. The men were studying the U.S. Constitution so they could answer questions used in poll tests that were meant to limit Negro access to the ballot. Those tests often included questions about obscure aspects of the U.S. Constitution or Alabama state government. As a sailor in the Navy, my father was part of the battle to defend democracy overseas, but he returned to a country, and more specifically a southern state, where democracy was too narrowly defined to embrace Black people. After he left Alabama and migrated north, he never talked about getting wounded during that encounter with the police in downtown Birmingham. He never even told my mother in all their years of marriage. It turned out my mother was also holding tight to a hidden story. I learned that my maternal grandmother worked for Quaker Oats as an itinerant Aunt Jemima in the 1940s and 50s, doing pancake demonstrations at county fairs and Chamber of Commerce events, traveling across a six-state region in the Midwest with a hoop skirt and headscarf in her suitcase. My grandma Ione wore the costume, but she refused to speak in the presumed lingo of the enslaved that was part of a pre-approved script. Instead, she used her itinerant perch to conduct herself as an ambassador for her people. She served up pancakes using the crisp elocution I always remembered from my childhood. I uncovered news accounts covering her visits to some of those small towns, and in those articles, she told reporters about her work and how she saw her role. She knew she was standing before white audiences, and especially white children, who had never encountered a Black woman before. And instead of reinforcing a denigrating stereotype, she used that moment to show small-town audiences something that would blow their minds. Both stories were almost lost in the cavern of locked-away family secrets, buried under shame, angst, and the fierce desire to just keep moving forward. Instead of the book I had intended to write, exploring changing racial attitudes across America, I wound up authoring a memoir exploring how my own family carefully avoided certain conversations, hoping to submerge their pain and set the next generation on a path towards something better. I embarked on a 36-city book tour that kept me hopscotching across the country for weeks. In places like Seattle, Sacramento, Louisville, Des Moines, and Detroit, I spoke in bookstores, churches, and auditoriums, and at book festivals. I had hoped my book and the tour would jumpstart candid conversations about race, but I feared that audiences would cross their arms and go silent if I forced the issue. In my experience, people would rather eat their toenails than participate in a no-holds-barred conversation about race. I needed something to draw audiences in, and I found it by asking people to participate in a six-word exercise through something I called the Race Card Project. I've always cringed when the accusations fly about someone allegedly playing the race card. It's usually a proxy for, you're making me uncomfortable, so please stop talking, or it's a diversionary tactic used to avoid having to speak about race with any kind of precision or specificity, a shorthand for just shut up. So I flipped the script, turning that accusatory phrase into a prompt to spark conversation. I printed 200 little black postcards at my local FedEx Kinko's asking people to condense their thoughts on race or cultural identity into one sentence of six words. The front of the card simply read, "Race, your thoughts, six words. Please send." I left the cards everywhere I traveled, in bookstores and restaurants, at the information kiosks and airports, on the writing desk at all my hotels. Sometimes I snuck them inside airline in-flight magazines or left them at the sugar station at Starbucks. I hoped a few of those postcards would come back, thinking it would be worth the trouble if even a dozen people responded. Much to my surprise, strangers who stumbled on those little black cards would follow the instructions and use postage stamps to mail their six-word stories back to me in Washington, D.C. Since my parents were both postal workers, this gave me an extra thrill. Here I was doing my part to support the Postal Service. Who says snail mail is dead? Half a dozen cards arrived within a week, then 12, then 20. Over time, that trickle became a tide. Though limited to just six words, the stories are often shocking in their candor and intimacy. They reveal fear, disappointment, regret, and resentment. Some are kissed by grace or triumph. A surprising number arrive in the form of a question, which suggests that many people hunger not just for answers, but for permission to speak their truths. It was amazing what people could pack into such a small package.
Reason I ended a sweet relationship.
Too black for black men's love. Urban living has made me racist.
Took 21 years to be Latina.
I suspect Grandpa was a Jew.
Was considered white until after 9/11.
I tend to scare white people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.